Hello, and welcome to Eastgate Community Church. We are so glad you've joined us to listen to this message from our weekend encounter. We pray you are encouraged by what you are about to hear.
Welcome, Jeremiah. Come on.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Tom. It's great to be with you all on Sunday morning, and I love Sunday mornings. I've shared with many of you in Lakeland, Florida, full-time. I planted a church 7 years ago out of our living room with no money, no people, and the last 7 years have just been a fascinating journey of watching God work and trying to figure out how to get out of the way. And I remember our first little space that we had as 10 people and something like this, and there was a business on the other side of the wall that did Zumba. So the challenge for the first year was how to preach with a umska, umska, umska all the time, and how embarrassing that was. And we met in a ballroom dance studio. We met in a hotel. We leased a storefront. And just last year, we bought a $2 million, 40,000 square foot facility in Lakeland, and are just watching God. Just about 400 to 500 people every Sunday, Wednesday, just doing devotion, doing prayer together, doing family. We just dedicated 15 more babies. We're a baby factory right now. We have tons of young millennial families that are choosing to do the God dream and not the American dream, which we're going to talk a little bit about that this morning. And also just drawing just the older, as we call them, more mature. That's what they asked me to call them. More mature folks among us, and just wanting to do family, wanting a multi-generational expression. And so I just cherish these days with babies crying and just kind of trying to figure out what it looks like. It's beautiful. I would just encourage you, Tom and Scott, as the elders here have invited me in to help oversee this community and come a few times a year and pour into you guys, but also be on the phone with them and encouraging them. And I'm just really excited about what the Lord is doing in the Rockwall, the Dallas region, and really sensing his promises and his purposes for you. So thank you all for receiving me. On Friday night, we kind of got into this flow of the Holy Spirit's ministry in the last days. I woke up yesterday morning with this crazy burden for the worship and prayer movement that's coming to the Dallas region, and I just couldn't shake that. And so we just kind of, that was wild last night. Do you guys think that was wild? That was kind of like Jeremiah unplugged. We just like, you know, my brother Mark here is always telling me, don't hold back. I tend to hold back if people don't know me. In Lakeland, you can imagine, I just go wild all the time. Our elders, so they're used to strong preaching and calling everybody to repentance and get right with God and miracles bursting out and all these things. So I'm just working my way in with you all. But I really just want to encourage you. I know we've been Facebook living, especially that message last night. If you're in the Dallas area, check out our Facebook page, Behold the Man Ministries. It's there. But I really just sense that the Lord is doing something. He's charging us not to be negligent, to stand before him and to minister to him and burn incense to him. So I'm excited about that. I do want to just jump into, I guess you could call it more of a pastoral message this morning. I really want to challenge us. I've talked a lot this weekend about the difference between the American church and the New Testament church. And a lot of people have had questions. You know, I've made statements like, we're getting people saved on the streets and we're welcoming them into a church that looks more like Babylon than the New Testament church. And a lot of people are saying amen, but they don't even know what I'm talking about. So I'm gonna try to bring a little bit more clarity. We're gonna try to dive into the word. And you know, again, my definition of pastoral is encouraging and challenging. Okay, so we're gonna pray. If you guys want to check that back table, we did bring some products this time around. I love to give free stuff away before we pray. Just want to tell you a little bit of what's back there. On the subject of the Holy Spirit, there is a school of the Holy Spirit that I do called Pneuma Training, 1 Corinthians 12 through 14. This is a workbook here with 8 weeks worth of lessons. The answer key is down at the bottom. And so if you want to really get into the Holy Spirit's ministry, there's everything here from exposing the accuser of the brethren, the pursuit of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, prophecy, the baptism and gifts of tongues, physical manifestations of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians 14 meetings, which we talked about last night a little bit. There's a workbook here if you like to write. There's also a CD series as well if you like to listen to stuff in your car. But who can I bless this with? All right, firsthand I saw. There you go. The power of the resurrection. I hate Easter services in America. You know, we celebrate the resurrection, but we're not living it. And Easter's coming up in April, and just really want to encourage you, if you want a deeper understanding of the power of the resurrection and what's been made available to us because Jesus is alive, I want to encourage you to grab this. Who can I give this to? Okay, I saw your hand. There we go. Don't hit me, Lord. Oh, okay. There's a couple of books back there that I've written. This one, I See a New Prophetic Generation. How many of you have read this? I know some of you have got it. I just want to encourage you. Dr. Michael Brown, he said, if this book offends you, it's the very thing you need. And so this is just a deeper understanding into the prophetic ministry and some of the counterbalance that God is bringing. We just recently wrote a book called The Micaiah Company, A Prophetic Reformation. That's also on the back table. All right, I'm going to give it to you. There you go. Amos, Hear the Lion Roar. The Lord really came after me last year about the prophet Amos and about how he wasn't the son of a prophet. He didn't call himself a prophet. He was a marketplace person, and he showed up out of nowhere because he had heard the lion roar. And I believe the Lord is roaring in the marketplace all over America. And people are like, I'm not a prophet. I didn't go to Bible college or seminary, but I know God has spoken. And I want to encourage you, if you're in the marketplace here, pick up this CD. I think it'll encourage you that God can use you even where you're at. So I call it taking the secret place to the marketplace. Who can I bless this with? Okay, the guy on the end in the turquoise and, yeah, the gray. That's you. Okay. Not, yeah, it's not for me. It's for her. We used to have a series called Jealousy, and it never sold. So we repackage it to something like Your Destiny, and it sold out. This is another one, Revival Culture. This is a 7-CD series that we did. I did it off of a 21 or 40-day fast, and one of the words the Lord had given me was, if you're not on fire for Jesus Christ, it's not because the church you attend isn't, but because your personal life with Jesus isn't. And I think we blame the church and church leadership way too much for why we're dry. And there's many messages here about fasting, being poor in spirit, burning with the urgency of the hour, restoring legitimate authority in revival. One of my favorite messages, number 7, turn the power back on. Yeah. And so this is kind of like a high-powered, if you want a shot in the arm, it's really going to mess you up. I'm going to give it on all the way in the back row. Yeah, come on down. I always say you're on the prophet is right. Price is right. Simon, arrogant. All right, if you have in your Bibles, would you turn to the book of Acts? Thank you, Lord. Book of Acts. We're going to look at Acts 1 and 2, and then we're also going to jump into Luke chapter 14. So, Father, we just thank you for this time this morning, and we thank you for the ecclesia, your body that is gathered here. And God, I pray over every husband and wife, every child, Father, every person here that's longing for their spouse. Father, we ask that you would, Lord, come and have your way in our midst tonight, God, or this morning. God, I pray for a fresh baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. Lord, I pray for the spirit of prophecy to come in and make your heart and your will known to us. God, we thank you for your word. Every word in the Bible is oozing with anointing and revelation. And Lord, we read it today, not just for information, but for impartation. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. So I grew up in Indianapolis, Indiana, with a father who pastored a charismatic church for 25 years. And I was one of those kind of weird kids where I had my mom had a dream when I was in the womb to name me Jeremiah, and that I would be a prophet to the nations and things like that, but that Satan would try to kill me on many different occasions. And so I was born dead in the hospital. The cord was wrapped around my neck. They immediately took me away, and they miraculously revived me. I was known as a miracle baby in the Miami, Florida hospital. And it was evident to my parents that there was something different about me. They really weren't sure what. And so I began to dream prophetically at a very, very young age. And I told you last night, my dad began to give me the microphone at as early as 7 years old. In his church, we would have people that would show up and say, someone here has a prophetic word for me. And they would say, it's that little boy right over there. And so I was kind of introduced into the prophetic. Signs and wonders were normal in our church. I realized when I went to Bible college, I went to the largest Assemblies of God school in the nation, and I most often minister in Assemblies of God churches all around the nation. But I realized that the ministry of the Holy Spirit has oftentimes been regulated to a sign by the road. Yeah. So, you know, we're Assemblies of God, Church of God, we're Spirit-filled, but not really. There's really nothing that's happening in this service that's indicating to me that the Spirit of God is moving. I've often said that sometimes we're trying so hard not to be religious that we've become religious. Yeah. And we have revival services in these conferences, and you can literally predict what's going to happen before it starts. What's revival in nature about that? And so I just kind of grew up in this atmosphere, really, really blessed. To have parents. My mom was a painter, prophetic painter, a dreamer. My father was very prophetic in nature. So I was blessed to kind of grow up in this atmosphere that made me believe that I was really hearing God, and I didn't have to be 45 with a PhD to tell people what I thought the Lord was saying. And so it's kind of out of this experience of not only going to church, but being the church. And as a pastor's kid, you know, my brothers and I, one of four boys, our favorite thing to do during the week, like the sanctuary, was our daycare, right? So we would stack all the pew chairs and make forts and, you know, get Nerf guns, and, you know, we just owned the church. So just kind of grew up in this supernatural environment where I just believed everything that the Bible said. Is that okay? You know, like the words of Jesus and the book of Acts. But as I went to Bible college and I started traveling around, I recognized that I just began to call it the American church. And I began to compare it to the New Testament church. And so I believe as new believers, as believers in Jesus Christ, there's a clear pattern set out in Scripture. And we can choose to follow the pattern, or we can choose to follow American man-made, the traditions of men, of their rendition of what it means to be a church. And this is why I'm most excited to be a part of this community here, because you guys can actually give yourselves to being a New Testament church. You don't have to be an American church. The things that we read about in the Bible here can actually manifest in our midst, and we can grow up and cultivate environments of the supernatural. We can literally have these babies and young children being baptized in the Holy Ghost at 4, 5, and 6 years old. That was my Sunday school. The kids don't have a junior Holy Ghost. There's no such thing as a junior Holy Spirit. And so I'm just dreaming of places and realities, but we've got to get back to the book of Acts, and find out what was the blueprints, what was the main ingredients of the New Testament church, and then talk about some of our challenges in America to get there. So does that make sense? I'm going to take a few minutes. We're going to jump in the book of Acts and pull out some of the main ingredients of God's dream for a New Testament church. And then we're going to talk a little bit about some of our challenges that we have in America trying to get there. All right, so Acts chapter 2. We know in Acts chapter 1, Jesus revealed himself for 40 days, for a period of 40 days. He ascends and the disciples go to the upper room where they're tarrying and they're waiting for the promise of the Holy Spirit. It says that they were together, and in verse chapter 2, verse 1, and when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. In the following verses, it begins to talk about how tongues of fire begin to rest upon them, and there was a multitude that had gathered, and these men, these disciples, began to speak in other tongues, and people around them began to hear their own language. And so starting in verse 14, really all the way through 36, Peter begins to preach a sermon to those gathered there, and it was a very seeker-friendly sermon, you know, because the best way to grow your church is to tell people what they want to hear. That's actually not true biblically. Peter basically said to these people gathered there, "You crucify Jesus." He didn't try to skate around the issues, or he just said, "You crucify Jesus, repent." And the very foundation of the New Testament church was birthed on the message of repent. Yeah. And for some reason in the American church, the word repent is a cuss word. And I want to tell you, as a New Testament believer, that should be one of the best words that you can ever hear, because repentance brings refreshing. Repentance brings restoration. When the message of repentance is preached, I feel the love of God all over me, deep down in my bones, because it's his invitation to get closer with him. So Peter, he preaches this message of repentance in verse 37. "Now when they had heard this, the people were pierced to the hearts and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, 'Brethren, what shall we do to be saved?'" So I want you to get this picture. The power of God falls, the fire of God falls, the anointing is resting upon Peter and the disciples, and he preaches the message of repentance, and the sinners, those gathered there, their response was, Brothers Peter, what must we do to be saved? So it was the sinners asking the church, what do we have to do to be saved? And there's power and there's authority resting upon them. Now let's fast forward to the American church. There's so little power and authority resting upon messengers that now we flip-flopped it. Now it's the pastors and the preachers asking people, what do we have to do to get you saved? Okay, one more time. The apostles, they're in the upper room. Tongues of fire fall. There's power. There's authority. They preach the message of repentance. "You crucify Jesus. Repent and be baptized, every one of you." Spirit of conviction falls upon sinners gathered there. They say, "What do we have to do to be saved?" "We'll do anything." Fast forward to America. There's so little power. There's so little authority. There's so little boldness. There's so much compromise. There's so much watering down that now we, as the church, are asking the lost, what do we have to do? How do we have to package the gospel? What can we say to you to get you to come into the doors of our church and act like you're saved? And we actually think this is the best method to draw people. We are convinced that we have to water it down. As a younger preacher, I preach in, churches of 10,000 people or more around America every year. And I walk into the doors of these, you know, older men of the faith, and they constantly ask me, how do we reach your generation? You know, and they throw out ideas like, do we need a better light system, better fog machines? Do we need to build a better youth center? You know, do we need to do the skinny jeans and the V-necks? You know, do I need a new haircut? I mean, all these different things people are trying to do to draw people. And I'm like, you don't need any of that. You need to get locked up in the prayer closet.
Yeah.
You need to tarry in the secret place and get full of power and authority so that when you preach and you prophesy and you minister, the Holy Spirit draws people. So again, one of the tensions between American church and New Testament church is how we reach people. I've been asking, where are the bold preachers in America? The apostles during the week, they didn't strategize in boardrooms about how we could reach more people and how we could do this or that. I believe they got in the place of prayer. They did community together and the Lord added to their number. And that's one of the things I wanted to look at. Look at verse 41. So then those who had received his word were baptized, and there were added that day 3,000 people.
Wow.
Don't tell me the message of repentance doesn't work.
That's right.
For whatever reason, it's like we have to go to foreign countries to get convinced of this. I shared recently, earlier in January of this year, I went down to Peru. I preach at the largest church in southern Peru, of a city called Arequipa. You know, thousands and thousands of people were gathered in, you know, this large stadium. And, you know, they told me, you know, before the meeting started, these folks, you know, they have to leave at 9:30. They took the bus to get here. And if you preach longer, you know, they're going to leave. And so I said, okay. So I preach on the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. I ended at like 9:15 so they could catch the bus, and no one moved. So the pastor just looks at me and says, well, get back up there. Well, I preached and did altar ministry till midnight, and they all stayed. You're talking 20, 30,000 people didn't even move from their seats. And, you know, the guy takes me in the back, and, you know, he referred to himself as the Latin general. You know, he had been in ministry 40 years, and, you know, he knew everything about ministry, and I was just some kid, and which is fine, I don't care. And he's like, you know, what do you think happened? And I said, people won't stay when you're trying to patronize them. But when you introduce them to the realm of glory in the presence of God, they'll never want to leave. And so it's like we have to shift to foreign countries to be convinced. And, you know, I was up there preaching on the return of the Lord. I was preaching on repentance. I was telling this big seeker-friendly church, just because you attend church doesn't mean you're saved. And I really don't believe that. If you study the life of John Wesley and George Whitefield, some of the great revival preachers of history, one of the things that they never did is they never assumed that because people attended church on Sunday, they were saved. We're saved because we're disciples of Christ, and our life bears fruit because we're connected to the vine. You don't have to try to bear fruit if you're connected to the vine. Just connect to the vine, abide in intimacy with the Lord, and fruit will be a natural byproduct of your walk with Christ. So God's idea of birthing a New Testament church was tongues of fire, people speaking in languages that they've never, I mean, this doesn't seem secret, like, this doesn't seem like anything we're hearing about. Fire falls, tongues, repent, 3,000 are gathered. And then let's look at verse 42. What did they do with it then? How did they begin to establish the New Testament church? Verse 42. And on Sundays they devoted themselves. Oh, okay. It says, and they were continually. Okay, I'm trying to be funny. Thank you. Yep, here comes the American church tension. And they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to breaking of bread, to prayer. And everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And all those who had believed were together and had all things in common. And they began selling their property and possessions and were sharing them with all as anyone might have need. And day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were together with their meals, with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. Now, I remember when the Lord called my wife and I to plant a church. I remember that day very well. It was a day of sorrow. That was the last thing I wanted to do. You know, sometimes God kills your dream before he allows you to actually do it. He has to kill all the ambition. He has to kill all the pride. He has to kill all the, I call them pipe dreams, all our definitions of success. And I was working at a church. Holy Spirit was moving powerfully at a large Assemblies of God church. And we had taken a group of young adults up to a Morningstar conference with Rick Joyner and Bill Johnson. And some of those guys that I was sitting in the back and had this open vision. And Lord says, I've called you to plant a church. And I just start saying, oh God, no. I don't know what it is about me. It's like people ask me, you know, teach us to hear the voice of God. And I'm like, I mean, I have a prophetic school, but I just tell people it's really simple. The voice of God is that voice that you don't want to listen to. It's like most people are like trying to bind Satan. And I'm like, that's God. Like, for example, Satan would never tell you to give your money to the church. Yeah. I'm trying to help somebody. Called you to plant a church, and I'm weeping and I'm saying, Lord, I don't think so. This just happened to me last October. I was preaching a revival in North Carolina that had broken out for 6 or 7 days, and my punchline for the altar was, the Lord's going to turn your no into a yes. And they hit the altars, and I go back to the hotel that night and have a dream. My wife and I have 3 children, 5, 3, and 11 months. And, you know, my wife has really been pressing me about having another one. My wife is the kind of wife, when the baby's 6 months, she's ready for another one. And she's one of those ladies that, you know, she was babysitting at 12 and just always dreamed of being a mom and just, you know, all these different things. And so I had been resisting her and no, no, no. We're overwhelmed, all these things. And so I go back to the hotel at night, have this dream, and I'm seeing myself preaching, you know, the Lord's going to turn your no into a yes. And, you know, the Lord responds to me in the dream and says, I cannot allow you to continue to challenge my people without me challenging you. The scene shifts. She's pregnant. And I woke up out of the dream saying, oh God, no. So in my own way, I said, well, I've heard the Lord. I've just not accepted it yet. But anyways, I called my wife on the phone, boo-hooing, and repented to her and said, honey, we're all in. But my history has just usually been, you know, oh God, no. That's like, hello, that's him. I know what I was talking about. But anyway, so we have this vision, you know, to plant the church. And I tell the Lord no. And he begins to work his spirit inside of me. And so I start thinking, well, okay, the best thing to do is to go to church planning conferences. You know, surely there are other people out there who know what they're doing, and I'm a rookie. And so, you know, I'm going to church planning conferences within the Assemblies of God. I'm paying big money to fly to, you know, the West Coast and, you know, figure out how they do things and all these different things. And, you know, the Lord began to burden me with this Acts reality. And I can tell you, I think I went to something like 39 church planning conferences and seminars and never heard Acts 2 talked about at all. Zero. I never heard anyone talk about the essential ingredients of a New Testament church. They, of course, didn't touch Acts 1 about fire and tongues and repentance. I mean, but this whole thing of Acts 2, what they devoted themselves to, I'm going to tell you, there's four things in here that I'll briefly mention. But if these four things are not the primary ingredients in a community of believers, it's not a New Testament church. Now, it might be an American church and whatever their rendition of the latest, greatest CEO entertainment model, you know, I call it Babylon, I'm sorry. But whatever their rendition of, but let's look at this. Let's jump to 42. So it says that they continually devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. That's number one if you're taking notes. Secondly, they devoted themselves to fellowship. Thirdly, they devoted themselves to the breaking of bread. And fourth, they devoted themselves to prayer. So you have four ingredients. I just want to point some things out to you. So it says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. I mentioned this last night. So there are four ingredients. I break them up into pie pieces. So 25%. So 25% of what they did as the local, the community church was established, only 25% of that had to do with people sitting down and listening to a speaker. Contrast it. In the American church, that's most people, that's 100% of their Christianity. Yeah. I'm a Christian because I went to church on Sunday. What do you mean? I sat down and listened to somebody speak, and I'll see you next Sunday. So that's a piece of it. And again, I want to point out, that's only 25% of New Testament Christianity. The other thing I'd like to point out to you is, it says the apostles' teaching. So imagine the apostles, they were disciples of Christ and had walked with him and talked with him all through his ministry. What do you think they taught on? I hate to tell you, but they didn't develop series off of the latest movie, off of 10 Steps to a Better Life. Right. When we talk about apostles teaching, they actually preached Christ.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know it's crazy, but I honestly ask people, when's the last time you actually heard a message on Jesus Christ?
Come on.
Yeah. On his life, his death, his burial, his ascension, his second coming. You know, in Lakeland, obviously, as we've grown and we've bought a building and we've added, you know, all these, the things that come with local church work, one of the things that we've realized is that we are doing church in America and somehow missing Jesus. It's amazing. Good Christian people doing church, but we don't know the man. And so for us, our response to that was we completely shut down our Wednesday night service. We had, you know, worship, preach, I mean, the whole thing. And our response was, we're going to have a little bit of worship. We're going to break out into small groups, and we're just going to take one chapter of the Gospels a week, and we're going to center discipleship around the God-man. And here's the testimonies: deliverance from addiction, marriage is restored. I mean, it's amazing what happens when you just get people to read about his life. People in church 30 or 40 years giving us testimonies like, I'm stunned that I actually don't really know him. I don't know what he taught. I don't really know his miracles. Again, great Christian people, they've been tithing, they've been doing a good Christian life, but the Lord is drawing the church, I believe in this hour anyways, back to himself. He's drawing people back to what it really means to be disciples of Jesus Christ, but I also believe he's shifting what we're hearing from the pulpits. Rather than when people want to hear about the latest, greatest, whatever is going on, I believe the Lord is raising up men and women that have a real revelation of Jesus Christ. And this is what true apostolic preaching is. True apostolic preaching is the preaching of Jesus Christ. It's the preaching of the knowledge of God. It, when it goes forth, it literally shakes entire regions and nations. So the very first thing that they devoted themselves to. So again, it's two pieces. We've got to get beyond saying we're an American Christian because we go and hear somebody preach a sermon. And on the other end of it, in terms of church leadership, we've got to begin to have men and women that will give themselves, not during the week, to going golfing and, you know, the church has become some social club. And, you know, I've, you know, personally, again, this is just kind of Jeremiah coming out, but, you know, especially I just feel like there's a lot of church people in church leadership that are lazy. Like they see ministry as, I guess I'll just work a day or two a week and I'll go on vacation all the time. I'll golf with people. It's like, you know, they're rock stars. And my heart is, why aren't you fasting and praying during the week? Why aren't you getting a fresh word from God? Why, when you open up your mouth, is God, the spirit of conviction, not falling upon entire communities of believers? And yet we get mad when people won't tithe. Mm-hmm. You know, I take that really seriously. People, we're asking people to tithe who are out there busting their butt during the week to try to make a living. And we want to stand up and ask them for 10%, and we're just being lazy. I don't think that's what Jesus died for. I don't think that's a standard in ministry. So I feel like there's a real shifting and a real shaking that's going on, even about this whole apostolic teaching. So I want to, again, just encourage us to think about that. So secondly, fellowship. Now, this Greek word for fellowship, the Luke who wrote Acts, he uses the word koinonia. How many of you have ever heard of this word? Koinonia is the strongest word for fellowship in the Greek. This word, fellowship, and obviously we can talk about fellowship, it means community, but this word has such deep meaning, it can literally be translated intercourse. So I'm talking about more fellowship than what we did to start service. You know, hey, how you doing, brother? I have no idea who you are, but let's worship. Praise the Lord. I mean, I'm talking about deep, intimate community and fellowship with one another. This is what it means to be part of the New Testament church. Now, I hate to tell you, but God, family, and church is not in the Bible.
That's right.
That's a really good saying that we've come up with in America that helps people justify whatever that they're doing. But I don't see God, family, and church in the Bible. What I see is families doing the kingdom together. There's been this really interesting shift. You know, there are a lot of millennials in the earth who, you know, were at church 24/7. Their parents were at church 24/7 and neglected them. So it seems in years past, people really worshiped the church. But now I believe what's happening in young generations is people are worshiping family. Child worship among millennials is through the roof. Spouse worship is through the roof. And so, you know, we could jump into some passages of scripture. You remember when they came to Jesus and said, hey, your family's here? And he says, who is my brother? Who is my mother? This is the Lord now, bringing his family. And he's saying, who is my brother? Who is my mother? My father, but they who do the will of the Father. And so I get nuclear family and I have my kids and I have my wife. But again, when we accept Jesus Christ and we're born into the kingdom of God, the spirit of adoption comes upon us. We are welcomed into a family of believers. My question is, why aren't you seeing the people that you go to church with as real family members? Yeah. It's like people miss church because I got to go be with my family. I'm like, okay, I get it, but I don't.
Yeah.
Okay, is this challenging? This, if this isn't challenging, you're not hearing me. This should be.
Yeah.
We want, you know, everybody reads the book of Acts. We want New Testament results. Like everybody goes on a fast. What book are we going to read? Acts. Man, they healed the sick. The cities were getting done. I'm like, but what did they cultivate on a daily basis? They gave themselves to the apostles' teaching, but they learned how to fellowship. They had intimate relationship with one another. And again, remember, I'm the guy with three kids. I pastor, I fly all around. Here's what I tell people. What you place value on, you'll make time for.
That's right, yeah. That's right.
Okay, so I know everybody's busy, and I hate those games where the one guy acts like he's the only one busy. I get that we're all busy, but what we value, we make time for.
That's right.
And I believe that the foundation for all New Testament ministry is relationship. The church is not an organization, it's an organism. It's a living, breathing, active, and we're going to get into this, but one of the reasons why New Testament Christianity is so resisted is because it cuts on people's personal time.
Yeah.
We have become masters at compartmentalizing Christianity. God, family, church. We have all these boxes, and my question is, why not invite God into the midst of all of it? Who's going to go eat after church? I mean, I'm going to assume, unless you're fasting, is it really that hard to invite somebody to go eat with you? I mean, it's really not that. I mean, you know, and again, if you really, you know, if you really want to get to know him, you can invite him into your home. When we planted the church and, you know, people started coming, we started preaching language of relationship and intimacy and community. I mean, people came from the woodwork. It was crazy how many people come in. My wife and I, we would invite couples in their 50s, let's just say, a couple that I'm thinking of, they come into our home, sit down for dinner, and start weeping. We're looking at each other like, did we do something wrong? We haven't even eaten yet. Sitting there. And they say, Jeremiah, my wife's name is Morgan. We've been serving at a church for 30 years and not only not ever been invited out to dinner by the pastors, we've never been invited in anyone's home.
Wow.
And there was a great opportunity to say, then you were not a part of a New Testament church.
That's right.
That's not what Jesus died for.
That's right.
Jesus Christ did not die for a 45 minutes and $25 in the bucket.
That's right.
All right, how are we doing? Is this? It's amazing. Somebody prophetic like me is actually preaching community, right? Because the problem with prophetic people is they're a bunch of lone rangers, and you know they need some love. But intimate fellowship, close relationship. Again, I want to challenge you to get practical. How can you, as a part of a New Testament community, how can you begin to build relationship with the people around you? Whether it's going out to eat, whether it's inviting them into your home. And again, I get it, there are levels, right? You know, sometimes you kind of, if you're not sure about them, you just take them out to eat because there's an escape route, you know? Or it's like, you know, if you invite somebody, it's usually with young people, I'm like, man, these kids, they will not leave. You know, you've given them all the signs, and it's like 3 a.m., and I'm like, just get out. Just get out of my house. I love you, but I don't. No, I'm just kidding. All right, apostles' teaching, intimate fellowship. Next one, breaking of bread. Now, this just doesn't mean going out to eat. When they broke bread as the New Testament church, it was called communion. I really believe if we took more communion in the American church, we could have revival. Because here's what communion does. It sets the sacrifice of Jesus Christ right in front of the face of people and asks them to examine their hearts to see if there's any sin, which is a cuss word today, to see if there's any sin, to see if they need to repent, another cuss word, and give them an opportunity to get right with God. So if we're going to be a New Testament community, guess what needs to happen when we gather weekly? We're going to have to go down to the Bible bookstore and get some juice, and get some crackers. We're going to have an opportunity, and we do this in Lakeland. We love it because it, I mean, people get healed. We see physical healing all the time. No one lays hands on anybody. They just take communion. We see God connecting people, friendships. Prayer breaks out during the service because, you know, the young adults are over here taking communion. They start laying. So communion, but I want to encourage you too. I mean, does anybody in here, you regularly invite people over to your house? Raise your hand. I mean, you're down with that. Okay, when's the last time you did that and took communion? Because I just don't want to limit it to a public meeting. My wife and I, we have people over the house all the time, and we take communion together. And again, it's not, you don't have to be like some, you know, spiritual whatever. I get it. We eat, we talk, we hang out. But before they leave, I say, hey, let's take communion together in the kitchen. Let's lock arms and pray. Say, Lord, thank you for your, hey, he's not dead. He's alive. Do this in remembrance of me. And people get this mournful. I'm like, he's alive. It's a celebration service. Because he lives, I'm dead to the flesh. And I mean, there's a lot of things in there. So I want to encourage Eastgate Community Church. I want to encourage you, if you're visiting, let's, or even in your home, let's make communion breaking bread. And again, if you want to, you can add going to Applebee's and all those kinds of things as breaking bread. But all right. And then fourth, prayer. I said it last night. I want to say it again. The Lord is not looking for people to build ministries. He's looking for people to build an altar. The New Testament church was birthed from a corporate prayer meeting, the upper room, and it was sustained by house-to-house corporate prayer meetings during the week. As a leader in the body of Christ, I refuse to define success and fruit in a church without considering how much time people are giving themselves to prayer. The church in Lakeland, we have 20 hours of live prayer and worship during the week. We have 10 two-hour prayer sets of live worship and singing where our community comes out and they do devotion. They get into the place of prayer. On Mondays, our business owners get together. A business owner leads the prayer. They get together 6 a.m. on Mondays, all the business owners, and they invite God into their week and say, your kingdom come. There's no pastors there. There's no spiritual people. It's business owners that are full of God that the Lord wants to use in their workplace. We have on Friday nights from 10 to midnight, we've got like 100 young adults who pray for revival on college campuses every Friday. I lead the Wednesday morning prayer set from 6 to 8 a.m. and we pray for unity in Lakeland. We lift up our voices. We pray for the pastors. We pray for the churches. We pray that God would get the Baptists and the Methodists during the week and whatever else you want to pray. But I want to encourage you, part of being a part of the New Testament church is giving yourself to a life of prayer and devotion. Show up to a church service that has prayer during the week, but I encourage you to begin to crack open your Bible. A lot of people say to me, I know that verse. I like to ask people, but does that verse know you?
Yeah.
Just believe the Lord's breathing on devotional lives in this room. He wants to meet you and commune with you and fill you with his word. Again, I'm trying to get us out of, well, Pastor, that was a great sermon on Sunday. See you next week. And what that means is we just go back to our life, do whatever we want, hang out with our family all the time, and then, okay, we're back. Not New Testament Christianity. I was a little deceived a couple years ago because I thought that everybody would want to hear this message. And a guy had been visiting from a church down the road, you know, big, big church. And, you know, somebody had invited him and, you know, he asked if he could meet with me. And, you know, it was kind of one of those where, you know, the guy cussed me out, gave me the middle finger and, you know, walked out of the restaurant type meetings. I didn't even say anything to him, so don't blame me. This guy was mad at God, and sometimes in ministry, people are mad at God means they're mad at you as a minister because you represent God, right? And this guy just goes off on me, and he just starts yelling, and I'll never forget it. And he said, you know what? I don't want your New Testament Christianity stuff. He said, I would rather go back to my church, sit in the balcony, no one know my name, throw in my offering, and be left alone. And you would think that this language of intimacy and community and prayer and fellowship would touch everybody, but it really doesn't, because the problem is when you get in relationship and community, you have to get vulnerable. Yeah. You can't hide your stuff anymore. Yeah. And I'm convinced a lot of people, that's what they're looking for. They're just looking for a place where they can just hide out. I mean, the Lord has had me do crazy stuff. I remember year two of the church plant, we're in a place like this, and we don't even have enough money literally to run the AC during the week. And my office is there, and I dressed up faithfully. I don't know why I did this, but I dressed up, and I would literally sweat in Florida. Soaking sweat. It's 83 degrees during the summer, and we're just plowing. I mean, this is like those. I'm cutting the church grass. I mean, I'm doing everything. I mean, we couldn't even get the space unless I offered to cut the grass of the plaza so we could have like an extra $100 off the thing. So I'm just sitting there, and I'm soaking sweat, and I go out to the mailbox, and a check comes, and I'm like, oh, praise the Lord. It's from a business owner in town, and it's, you know, $2,000 or whatever. And it was like exactly what we needed, and we went wild and crazy. And so this man started doing this over a period of months, and we had to have that check to operate. And the third month comes around, and I start having this conversation with the Lord. He says, well, have you seen this man? And I said, no. You know, he said, well, do you know if he even knows me? Or, you know, I want you to connect with him. So, you know, I had breakfast with him and basically found out, you know, this guy, basically he cleared his conscience with giving a check to the church, but wasn't really living for the Lord. Yeah. So like he was just out of obligation. And so, you know, that third or fourth month, the Lord said, I want you to send the check back. I want you to send the check back to him with a note that says, your money can't buy your salvation.
Yeah.
See, but that's seriously cost me. That was like, you know, I was sweating, and I was going to be sweating on the street. I mean, trust me, I understand church planning. I could tell you crazy faith stories. We've done it. We're going to continue to do it. But there's certain sacrifices that we have to make as part of the New Testament church if we're really going to walk in the fullness. But it's this New Testament Christianity, it chafes up against many of our schedules, many of all these different things. And so I want to kind of close this morning. And verse 43, it says, everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place. So it says everyone was feeling a sense of awe, and then signs and wonders were taking place. Here's what I want you to understand. I don't believe they were full of awe and wonder because of the miracles.
That's right.
That probably was part of it. They were in awe and wonder over the community and intimacy that was developing in their midst. Are you in awe and wonder over the community and the intimacy that's being formed in your community? That's challenging. But it can be done. It can be done. We can do New Testament Christianity, but there are sacrifices. So let's talk about those, and we'll close. You can get your tomatoes ready. Luke 14. That's okay. Luke 14, let's close here in verse 16. Jesus tells a parable. But he said to them, Luke 14:16, a certain man was giving a big dinner, And he invited many. And at the dinner hour, he sent his slave to say to those who had been invited, "Come, for everything is ready now." But they all alike began to make excuses. Mark, Jesus just cuts to the heart of it. The first one said to him, "I have bought a piece of land and I need to go out and look at it. Please consider me excused." And another one said, "I have bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm going to try them out. Please consider me excused." And another one said, "I have married a wife and for that reason I cannot come." And the slave came back and reported this to his master. Then the head of the household became angry and said to his slave, Go out at once into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in here the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. And the slave said, "Master, what you have commanded has been done. Still there is room." The master said, "Go out into the highways along the hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I tell you, none of those men who were invited shall taste of the dinner." So Jesus is speaking in a parable, but obviously he's speaking prophetically about a great dinner, a great feast that he had prepared for many. And he sends out these invitations, and obviously there are 3 excuses here. Number one, somebody bought a piece of land. Number two, somebody had oxen to take care of. And number three, somebody had married a wife. And so one of the questions that will get down to a core issue here we have to ask ourselves was, what was so sinful about a piece of land, oxen, and a wife? What was so bad about those things? It's not really a trick question. It was really nothing. What was wrong with the oxen, the wife, the piece of land? I'll give you another example. Abraham sacrificing Isaac. Well, what was wrong with Isaac? What was so sinful about him? Why would God ask Abraham to sacrifice his son Isaac? Why would Jesus choose to use these 3 examples, and we could apply them to many of our lives? Why would he use 3 common examples? And what I would like to put before us this morning is maybe Jesus wasn't looking for ordinary followers. Maybe he was looking for an extraordinary group of followers. See, what I see, and I just call them good Christian people, and I'm not being facetious or sarcastic. Please hear me. And again, remember, I'm in a local church. There are many great, good Christian people in America. What do I mean by that? I believe they both have a call on their life. I believe they're living for the Lord. They tithe, they give. They're a part of the church community. Okay, they're not drinking, they're not smoking, they're not having an affair. You know, a lot of your, and I'm just gonna generalize, because you know, a lot of we're white, middle class. We're good people. And as believers, the reason why we think we're good people is because we're not out at the bar and we're not sleeping around. And so when messages come forth, you know, we examine ourselves and we say, okay, we're good with God, because there's nothing really that bad in our life. And what I want to propose to you this morning is maybe that's not what God is after.
Amen. That's right. Yeah. Good.
Maybe that's not what God is after, because again, thousands and thousands of good Christian people leave church every Sunday and they do the checklist. Not drinking, not smoking, not having an affair. We're good with God. We'll see you next Sunday. Don't bother me. But what I believe Jesus is after here in this passage of scripture is he's saying, I'm not coming after that ordinary stuff. The company that I'm actually looking for in the earth is not, I'm not coming after the sinful stuff. I'm coming for your good stuff. And some of us have to re-examine and rethink what God is actually desiring if we want to be part of a New Testament community of believers. Hope you're hearing me. Well, what's wrong with television? Nothing really. Well, what's wrong with a vacation? Nothing really. I mean, how many things could you say in your life? Well, there's nothing really sinful about that. Yeah, but maybe that's the very thing that God wants. Yeah. And I'm going to tell you, it's the people that are willing to give up those good things that inherit God things. It's those people that are willing to sacrifice their time and their schedules that actually become part of the New Testament church. So here's a challenge. What does God want from you? If we're going to do this apostles' teaching, if we're going to do fellowship, if we're going to do prayer, if we're going to become a family, what is that going to cost you? I'm not even yelling. Praise God. This is just me, raw and real. This is it. This is the kingdom. Yeah. Do we, you know, and again, I bless them. I think that there are a lot of good Christian people attending good Christian churches. I mean, that's great. Again, are they going to heaven? Yes. Do I think they love the Lord? Yes. Do I think they're doing New Testament Christianity? No. Are they seeing New Testament results? No. But I don't know where you're at. I don't know what your heart is longing for. But if your heart is longing to do the same things that Jesus did and more, if you read the book of Acts and you read the New Testament and you're like, oh my gosh, we're short. This very practically is how we get to where we want to go. Some of us need to have hard conversations with our spouses. And again, and I can testify this, where the rubber, especially with finances. Maybe we can't go on that third vacation this year because we gave it to the missionary in Peru. I'll really get myself in trouble and then I'll close. I know that there are circumstances and there are situations in America where you have a single mom, or you have some situations where parents have to work just a lot. But I believe that if many of us would simply simplify our life, that we would walk and see the kingdom at a much higher rate than we are right now. Most people, they're working too much and they're away from home too much because they have to pay their car payment that's way too high. Yeah. Yeah. Most people are overextended because they're living in a house five times as large as they really need. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I can really go for it.
Yeah. Yeah.
We can talk about moms. Maybe we don't need to go to work. Maybe the Lord would call us to stay at home, but because we want all the extra glitter of life, I'm going to spend years away from my child rather than I could just have lived simply and been with them all the time. I'm not saying this is a prophetic word, but we should seriously ask ourselves that question.
That's right.
Because when you get in, you know, and again, I work among people. I mean, I have the conversations with the business owners, but when you really get into it, I agree, people are busy. But my question is, do you need to be that busy? I've watched the gospel rock multimillionaires so hard that they sold everything, simplified their life, because that's how bad they wanted New Testament Christianity. Mm-hmm. Some of us, what we think is generous to God is not generous at all. And so my wife and I, when we got hit with this, I mean, we've canceled all debt. I don't have any debt. I mean, we live debt. Why? Not so that I could have more things, but so that I could give more to the kingdom of God. All right, so are you feeling, did I release this tension in the atmosphere? Ooh. But that's good. Go home and wrestle.
Yeah.
Don't get mad at the preacher. Jump into the Word of God and say, Lord, what does this look like for our life? Does this need to be affecting the way that we spend money? Does this need to be affecting the way that we spend our time? Does this need to be affecting who I'm building relationship with? Listen, I prioritize relationship by who's in our family of believers. I've changed my lingo. I don't tell people I'm going to church. I tell people I'm going to be with my family. Of course, oh, is your uncle going to be there? Not my blood uncle, but my uncle in the Lord. This is awesome. Like, I have hundreds of fathers in my life. I have my earthly dad, but I consider so many people, they're my dad, my mom, my brother and my sister. We're a tight-knit community, and this is what sustains revival. This is what sustains the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, is people doing fellowship and relationship with one another, but there's a cost. Jesus put it like this, if any man wants to follow me, pick up his cross, die to himself, and follow me. All right, let's pray, and then I'll pray for some of you guys. Father, we thank you for this morning. Lord, we thank you for your word. And God, we just come before you once again. Lord, what are our excuses in this room? We all have them. Lord, I thank you for the changing of mindsets. Lord, I believe that you recalibrated many of our thinking. Maybe we thought that you were coming after the sinful stuff, which you do. But maybe what you're after in this season is the good stuff. Hear the Lord saying, all I want you to do is wrestle with me. Father, we say yes to the wrestle. We say yes to the sacrifice. Lord, I thank you that a New Testament community of believers is being birthed in Dallas. This couple come. Ma'am, your striped shirt and then your husband's next to you. I believe. Will you guys come? It's thick in here. You feel the presence of God? It's like that. He's pressing us. Thank you, God. Just get a bunch of words as I've been looking at you guys this morning. Revival, prayer and worship, the prophetic, pastoring. Father, we thank you for this couple that you have called as forerunners and pioneers in this generation. You have not given them a spirit of fear, but love, power, and a sound mind. And I see you all plowing a field, preparing for the people to come. And And I really sense strongly that the Lord is calling you at some point in the future to plant a New Testament expression of church. I believe it's going to look dynamic. It's going to be a new wineskin type thing. But the Lord has been teaching you and He's been training you for many years now. He's been developing the leadership callings on your life. And I just see I see youth and young adults. I see people that are hungry for organic, hungry for real, that are tired of the show. They're tired of the performance and the motions. God is going to supernaturally connect you all with the right people. I just sense like divine connections are coming. I just hear the Lord saying, will you lay your life down for me? Even as you've said yes in the past, I'm asking again, will you lay your life down for my sheep? The cost will be greater than ever before, but great will be your reward. I will reward you with my presence. I will reward you with my power and grace. I will reward you with who I am. Just sense that a lot of people's eyes are going to be upon you in the years ahead. I see connections all over America connecting with different movements and different streams, and you all are carrying an impartation from many different movements. And I just feel like the Lord is saying, do not be boxed in. Something very organic. There's something you've been trying to look for a model and a pattern. In fact, the Lord is saying you both will only ever be satisfied when you find it in the Word. You are people of the Word. Your heart is hungering for the Word. I see in the years ahead a lot of money going to missions and a lot of sending young people on the mission field back and forth. Like I see a lot of strikes in foreign countries with the gospel going forth. There's something very unique about you guys where you're not only hungering for the real gospel, but you're hungering to take care of the poor and the needy and the broken. And I just sense that the Lord is saying, you all, you receive counsel, you're submitted. But don't be surprised in the years ahead by what you feel like the Lord is saying to you is not well received by some counsel. I see a lot of tight grip on you guys. It's almost like people are afraid. I'm revealing their heart to you, but they're afraid that if they release you, what you'll really do for the kingdom of God. And we need covering, we need accountability. But I just feel like the Lord is saying, man will not release you, but I will. I just see like this list of why you're not ready and why you can't and all these different things. And the Lord, I just seen eraser, just erasing that list. So Lord, we just thank you for this word and this couple, Lord, whatever that you want, Lord, let it rest in their spirits and whatever needs to fall to the ground, let it fall to the ground in Jesus' name. You're in that row by yourself, young man. Yeah, will you come? Yeah. And you came because the Lord had something for you. Father, we just thank you. The Lord has created you for community. just see like a balm of intimacy and love and relationship. You were born for intimate relationship with brothers and sisters. And I keep getting this word like community organizer, where the Lord is putting this mantle upon you this morning to organize community. You are a connector of people. And I just sense that the Lord is going to use you to connect relationships as you continue to get connected with the Lord. There's a deeper commitment that the Lord is after inside of your heart. Like the Lord is saying, the deeper you commit to me, the deeper I'll allow you to connect and commit to others. Lord, I call forth the gift and the calling on the grace of this man's life. And where you didn't have that voice of encouragement, the Lord says, I will be your encouragement. Where you didn't have that voice of affirmation, I affirm you today in front of my people. This is my son, whom I love and whom I'm well pleased. Heaven is smiling over you. The Father deeply loves you and cares for your soul. I am the good shepherd. I am leading you and have led you all these years. And there is great hope and there is great light ahead. Just keep walking with me. Do not isolate yourself. Depression is there. Discouragement is there. Do not allow the enemy to lie to you any longer. I have not abandoned you. I have not forsaken you. I am your protector. I am your defender. I am your ever-present help in time of need. Through them. Whew. Thank you, Jesus. Sir, would you come right here in the brown? I got an interesting word for you. Thank you, God. I see young men, 30s, maybe late 20s, and they have small children, and you are going to bring a word to young men about it's better to spend time with your wife and kids than make more money. And I see a group of young men, and I feel like the Lord will use you in this over a period of years. But I feel like there's young men, the core issue is they don't know that God's their father, but they're trying to earn and strive and trying to prove to their wife that they love her, and just striving, crazy work ethic, and but they're forsaking their wife and their children. And you're going to bring a word to these young men and teach them about what's really important in life. And the Lord wants you to know He's chosen you for this, that this is something special, that you're qualified, and that the Lord is going to use your experience and the things that you've learned over many, many years. I just feel like the Lord wants to affirm you. You are a man of wisdom. And regardless of what people have said about you, there's great wisdom that you have about you. And I really see you helping young men navigate through like dangerous waters, where they can lose their business, they can lose their house, they can lose their family, and you're going to help them prioritize what's most important and then work from there. So I bless you with that. All right. Sir, you're wearing like a black sweater, like a vest, is it? Yeah, with the Yeah. Thank you, Lord. We've never met, right? Okay. Father, we thank you for this brother. And Father, I just thank you for the fivefold ministry calling that's on his life. And Father, we thank you for the anointing that's resting upon him even now. And I just fan into flame the gifts of God inside of you through the laying on of hands. And your heart has been longing for a father for many years to give you permission and to bless what you feel like the Lord is calling you to do. Lord says, I as your father am blessing you and releasing you into the work of an evangelist. And signs and wonders will follow they that believe. And you will preach the uncompromised gospel of Jesus Christ. I see missions. I see doors opening up for you where the Lord's going to give you favor. And you'll do some overseas traveling. And you'll have some engagements here in the United States, but the Lord is commissioning you. He's blessing you. He's releasing you into the call that's always been on your life. And the Lord loves your heart. Your heart is like gold before the Lord. You've desired purity above all else. And you are a pure man. There's a pure river flowing inside of you. And you, at times, you've questioned your motives and your intentions, and you've searched again and again, and you've sought the Lord with seasons of prayer and fasting. And the Lord is stamping his mark of approval upon you. I'm stamping you. Gentle heart. We bless you, Lord. We bless what you're about to do with this man. In Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus. I'm sorry, I feel bad for not knowing people's names. I've been here like five times. So, Janet, the couple behind you. Yes, I should know your names. Come on up. Will and Jennifer, come on down. I'm also terrible. I forget what I've prophesied to people in the past, so whatever. Man, I just, every time I see you guys, I saw it again. Like, your house is full of people. Just can't shake this. I see young people. I see lots of food. I see like football on the TV. Just a safe place, a warm place, lots of laughter and love, like a breath of fresh air from the world. This is spiritual, though. I feel like sometimes you would think that food and football and conversation and laughter is not spiritual, but I feel like the Lord is calling you all to reach a generation that's in transition. So it's like they're not just submerged in the world. I don't know that they've really bought into the full gospel yet, but they're just unsure, and they're in transition from radical darkness to radical light. And I thought the Lord would say to you all, I have called you to be a bridge. Yes. I have called you to be a bridge, a helping hand, a lending hand. The Lord's even going to give you more resources to help young people. I don't know to pay for what, but there's even just some increase coming just to help young adults, young people, college students just transition into deeper waters. Like, you're going to carry a message that there's more. But it's like the Lord is going to help you to know what to say and how to say it to different people. Sometimes you're going to have to be strong and confront sin. Other times it's going to be just laid back. And I just want to just encourage you. The Lord's voice is with you. It's inside of you. The Lord is going to give you young girls that will be like your twin. You will look at them and say, that was me X amount of years ago. And be bold. Be bold as a lion, says the Lord. Do not shrink back from sharing all of your testimony. I just feel like the Lord is saying, I am going to squeeze you out. I'm going to pour you out like a drink offering. And there'll be a fragrance, a perfume that will come before me. Something with high schools for you. It's like you know the locker room talk, or you know the, it's familiar to you, and so the Lord is, it's, you know, you just have a way with young men to kind of feel them out and diagnose them and just love them. Just the Lord's put a love of a father upon your life. Many young men needing the love of the Father, you're going to grant that to them. Just last thing, you all are supposed to go on some mission trip together, and it's going to radically impact your life. See you all on the mission field. And this isn't like one of those where you go to the orphanage and then stay at the Hilton. This is something that's pretty rugged and raw. And the Lord is going to awaken a cry for the real gospel like never before. It's going to be powerful. Bless you guys. In the blue, I should know your name too. What's your name? Kevin? David. David, I keep getting that God's desire is that you would be a pillar in the house of God. That you would be an established part of a community of believers. That you would be like a defender and a protector. That the Lord is coming to challenge you to open up. There's treasures inside of you that my body needs, says the Lord. There are not only mistakes that you've made, but there are obstacles that you've overcome that my body can benefit from. And I see you having even a word to share. There's even testimonies and smaller messages and things where the Lord would put his word in your mouth, and you have something to offer. You are a good son to a loving father, and I'm pleased with you. I've not brought you this far just to allow you to sit. I just see you standing as a pillar in the courts of God, being very instrumental as part of a New Testament community of believers. And so, Lord, I just silence all fear right now, all concern, all anxiety. I just come against an unsettling in your soul. Whatever's going on during the week, we just speak the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. I'm the God of the big, but I'm the God of the details. Going to work it all out. Don't feel like you have to defend yourself. I know the truth about you, and I'll fight for you. In Jesus' name. Amen. 16. Awesome. Father, we just thank you. I just want you to know there's a very special call on your life. The Lord marked you in the womb. And I believe that in some ways he's marked you for missions. I see a very creative nature about you that loves mystery, that loves novels. You love just suspense, stories and things, but I feel like the Lord is saying that I am writing a novel about your life. I'm writing a story about your life, and part of the story of your life is going to be that I'm going to use you to reach out to the broken and the hurting, and I'm going to use you creatively to give voice to those who don't have a voice.
Okay, Zoma voice. A Zion a fall.
Praise the Lord. I have little kids, it's all good. No, it's fine, it's totally fine. Maybe he said something. Just one moment. And Father, we thank you for your daughter. And I just thank you. I just feel like the Lord is saying, don't grow fearful. Don't worry. Don't grow anxious. I'm going to be with you every step of the way. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Don't worry. I started getting prophecies at 7. I'm like, I don't even know what they're saying, but amen. All right. We love you guys. Thank you so much for having me this weekend. Again, if you didn't get a word, it's okay. You have the Bible. It's a lot better word than I can give anybody. Thank you for having me. I am planning on coming back later this year. And we'll let you know.
Thank you for joining us. If you would like to know more about our community, please visit our website at East.